Welcome to ITFreeTraining's video on software deployment using group policy. Companies often have the need to manage software deployment. Without a system for software deployment, software can only be deployed manually, a process which is very time-consuming. In this video, I will look at the theory and concepts that you will need to be familiar with before using group policy to deploy software in your organization. In the next video, I will then look at how to configure group policy to deploy and manage software in your organization. Many organizations will use a software deployment solution to install software. Deployment solutions, such as Microsoft's own System Center Configuration Manager, allow the administrator to deploy software and perform other tasks like inventorying computers. If you do not want to spend money on a deployment solution, you can use group policy to deploy software. When choosing which software deployment solution to use, it is important you choose one that allows software to be installed without user interaction. It should manage the software through all parts of its lifecycle. That is, it should install, update, and remove the application as required by the company's needs. The system used to deploy group policy is called Group Policy Software Installation, or GPSI. Group policy provides the basic infrastructure to allow you to manage software in your organization. Using group policy software installation requires no additional software other than having a domain infrastructure. Software can be deployed per computer or user. Depending on whether you are deploying the software for the user or the computer, there are different options available. This brings us to the next topic I will be covering in this video: publishing and assigning applications in group policy. When you configure group policy to deploy software, the first decision you will need to make is if the software should be published or assigned. I will start with publishing an application, as this has the least amount of options and thus is the easiest to understand. Publishing software is only available to the user. You cannot publish an application to a computer or group of computers. Publishing software does not install the software on the computer, but gives the user a choice to install it. To install the software, the user needs to install the software via the control panel. Publishing is a good option if you have a large number of software titles that you want a user to have access to when they need to. Since publishing is hidden away in the control panel, this does not clutter up the user's start menu with software that they will never use. It is also possible to have the software installed automatically when the user opens a document associated with that software. For example, the extension used for a Word document could be associated with the Microsoft Office install. When the user attempts to open the Word document, Windows will automatically install Microsoft Office. Since the user makes the decision to install the software, they also have the option to uninstall the software. Publishing software essentially gives the user the power to install or uninstall software at will. The second choice you can choose when deploying software is assigning. Unlike publishing software, assigning can be done for both the user and the computer. First, I will look at assigning to the computer. When software is assigned to the computer, it is automatically installed on the computer when the computer starts up. This means that any user that logs into that computer will have that software available to them. Since the software is already installed, the option to have the software installed by associating a file extension with that software is not available. Lastly, when assigning software to a computer, the user will not have the authorization to uninstall it. Assigning software to the computer is basically forcing the user to have the software. They do not have a choice. The last choice you have when installing software is to assign it to a user or users. When software is assigned to the user, the software can be installed in one of two ways. First, it can be configured to be installed automatically when the user logs in. This means regardless of which computer the user logs into the domain with, when they log into this computer, the software assigned to that user will automatically install. The next way that software can be installed is via a shortcut, usually found in the Start menu or the desktop. When the user launches the shortcut, the application will automatically be installed. Assigned software can also be installed automatically when a document for that application is opened. For example, Microsoft Office could be installed automatically when the user attempts to open a Microsoft Word document. If the user does decide they do not want the software, they can uninstall it. Just remember, if you configure the option to install on login, the software will be installed the next time the user logs in. The last point to cover with the different deployment options is a zap file. A zap file will be covered in more detail later on in this video. If you have old software that does not support the modern way of installing software, a script called a zap file can be associated with the install to install the software. The modern way to install software is using the Windows installer. The Windows installer provides a standardized way to install software. With a standardized way to install software, there is also standardized file formats. The first file format is the MSI format. The MSI format contains all the files and configurations for the application. MSI files define the features that are available in the application and also additional information like which shortcuts should be created where. It is essentially a small database containing all the information the Windows installer will need to install the application. When you install an application, you are able to choose the options you want set up to use. In some cases, there may be options you may want to configure, but the setup does not always give you the chance to choose these options. When you deploy an application using an automated install system like Group Policy, the software is installed without any user interaction. Thus, the default options are used. To customize the install, it is possible to use low-level tools to modify the MSI package, but a better way is to create what is called a transform file. The transform file, or MST file, allows customizations to be applied to the MSI file when it is installed. These include adding extra shortcuts, configuring the install directory, and choosing which components to install. The manufacturer may provide software to create these transform files. For example, Adobe provides software to create MST files. Multiple MST files can be created with different configurations. It is just a matter of the administrator choosing which MST file they wish to use. Since MST files only contain changes, they are very small and require the original MSI file in order to be used. The next file is a patch file, or MSP file. This file contains updates or even service packs. If you can obtain an update in an MSP file, you can apply the MSP to the computer after the MSI package has been installed. Since the MSP file is only a patch file, if the MSI is not already installed, you will not be able to install the MSP file on the computer. MSI packages have been around for a long time, as such a large amount of software has been released in MSI format. If you are not able to get an MSI file for your application, you can create a text file called a zap file. The zap file is a script that will install the software. There are some limitations to zap files, and for these reasons they are not often used. First, a zap file does not support elevation. Elevation is the process for using a different set of credentials to install the software. The Windows installer can use the system account to install the software. This means that the user that logs into the computer does not require administrator access. In order to use zap files, the user that logs in requires enough access to install the software, which in most cases will mean administrator access. Software that uses a zap file cannot be reinstalled more than once on a computer. If the install fails, Group Policy does not attempt to install the software again. This is because Group Policy simply runs the commands in the zap file. It has no way of detecting if the install was successful or not. The last limitation of zap files is that they do not support rollback. If you deploy software using an MSI file, you can, at a later date, remove that software. If you use a zap file, you cannot configure group policy to remove the software at a later date. If the software has an uninstall function, you can manually use this to remove the software, but there is no automatic way of doing this using group policy. That covers all the theory and concepts that you need in order to start using group policy to deploy software. In the next video, I will look at how to start using group policy to manage your software. Thanks for watching this video from IT Free Training. See you in the next video.